Hi everyone. Had a couple hours sleep in the car. Been sleeping in the car now for, 3 weeks straight, maybe more now, could even be a month. That's just the stance I've taken. I refuse to support the system for all the reason you know and the work we do. Anyway, head's a bit foggy and sitting in the car waiting. Fiona's gone to do her work. And I wanted to kill some time, and I got the dogs in the back of the car. And if someone does walk by, we're in a park, and the dogs bark, I'm going to have to apologize now for it. But anyway, I wanted to have a shot at talking about the Achilles heel of law, of the rule of law. If I fail in doing it today, I'll have another shot at it another day. But anyway, here it goes. The first thing to look at is that the whole of the system is fiction. Pieces of paper, words, letters, numbers, and they're all definitions that form scripts, and we become absorbed in it because we've practiced it going to school, learning, listening to mum and dad from the womb, being exposed to technology, television, communications, all this sort of stuff. So this 24/7, we've gotten used to accepting the constructs and concepts, explaining everything that we are imagining to be true. And this is a constant bombardment. It's just definitions, 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 all this communication. Now, this is the first thing to be aware of, that none of this is real. None of it's true. It's just fiction. And there's no life in fiction. Like we can go to a living life form, call it a cow, and we can experience the life of the cow and its purpose. But you can't do that with definitions, letters, words, numbers, mathematics, geometry, everything. Everything that comes out of it. You can't do that because there's no life there. All we can do is imagine it, and we perform it through our imagining, no different to a child being exposed to the story of Superman and then becomes embroiled in it and starts wearing the Superman costume, encouraged by the parents or whatever, and turns the household into the props of Metropolis. And there's the child in the imagining of being Superman, set to all the scripts and all the good guys and the bad guys and all the characters and all the scenarios. And all of it is fake. None of it's true. And this happens with all of us as we grow up, where we think that the name, our birth certificate, and everything that's been given to us is true, when it ain't. It's not real. It's all been defined. It's words and letters, everything on pieces of paper, digital, hard drives. Now, this is the first thing to get your head around. It's all fiction. It ain't real. You can't go and talk to fiction. You can't go and witness the children of fiction playing. You can't go and visit the funeral places, the sites where the ancestors of fiction has been laid to rest. And you can't go and find, the descendants is the children that I've talked about. So none of this, there's no life there. And that's what Antichrist is. Christ means life. Been twisted by the occultists. It actually just means life. And anti-life, Antichrist, is fiction. And everything to do with fiction is dead. It has no life in it. So when you go to court, you're caught, caught, you're not court. You're caught because you are compelled to go into court as court, acting as the fiction, defined as Arthur's age, and whatever the claims may be that have been put down on pieces of paper. And if I have any emotion in me that compels me to act and acquiesce to the authority that calls me to court, I will move the vessel there into court. Now they will see the dead, the Arthur, before them. But if this man had his vessel dragged to court to go before an authority, and I know who I am, I'm not going to be dead because I know who I am. And now I'm not in fiction, and they can't contract with fiction. With a living man, I should say. So, why I pulled out of the system? Because I came to see this a long, long time ago. back in 2006 when I saw the name and realized what it was. It was fiction, and making it starts ever since. And so Fiona works in the system, I work outside of the system, and we work together, and she shares everything of the system, because everything's been compromised: the shelter, the food, the water, the car, the technology, the mobile phones. Everything I'm using is all coming through Fiona's good heart and sharing it with me. And people, there are people out there, assholes out there, intelligent. I said, oh, this guy's lazy. He just lives off Fiona and Fiona's labor and all that. And, you know, so he can just do what he's doing. And he's, you know, and try to riddle and play with my cat. And I don't buy into any of this stuff, because Fiona gives it willingly, because she has a dream that she lives for, as this man lives for, and we're breaking the system down. So we work one in, one out for this very reason. Now, an example of how that worked for us was recently in 2014, when the Ordo Templi Orientis came involved in our private lives through a lackey of theirs who posted defamatory material in multiple social media groups and websites, all related to exposing pedophilia and other satanic rituals and stuff that were going on. So this particular lackey was used to come to an unmoderated website that was Fiona's, that she owned, the loveforlife.com.au website. And we didn't know that this material had been posted. And then within 2 days, less than 2 days, we get a phone call from David Botra, who says that there's this defamatory material in the Love for Life website. And basically, in the end, it was all about he's going to sue us for $10,000 each and $29,000 for this material. And I said to Fiona, this is a scam. This is just trying to get at us, attack us, trying to weaken us, trying to scare, you know, break our marriage, do anything, you know, which they've tried multiple times, right back to 2006 through all our, I guess, propaganda work that we've been doing. Now, they stopped coming after the man Arthur because there was no Arthur on their paper. There was no tax file number, no credit card, no bank account, no check-in. There was no commerce being performed under the identity of Arthur Christie, because that was stopped back in 2005. So they had nothing to get at. Because Arthur had not committed a crime, not injured anyone, had not broken the peace, you know, all that. They had nothing, because they were relying on Caesar's laws of statute rulings and things that tied into defamatory kind of acts. Now, all they had left was to come after Fiona. So they kept going after Fiona and Fiona, and I said to Fiona, let's just play this out. Now, we started filing lots and lots of paperwork of a much, much bigger picture. In their courts, in ACAT, in their tribunal in Canberra. And Fiona's driving from Barrel, which is like almost a two-hour drive, to Canberra and back many, many times, dealing with this over 3 years. And in one, and the thing, the reason we did it is we wanted to document the experience. We wanted to show people the difference between fiction and life. Now, in the paperwork that we filed, and you can actually find that if you look in the temporary Love for Life website, because it's been was attacked and brought down in 2018, you'll find links to I think it's Darkness Visible Part 1. It could be Part 2. I can't remember which one it is, but it's called Darkness Visible. You'll find the documents in there. I copied over everything, bits and pieces of everything, of all these and other things, and put it on DocDroid, so, and they're embedded. So you can actually find them if you search for them in the loveforlife.com.au website. You see the documents, and what you see in there, we're exposing the lunacy of the living man, Fiona, and the claims they have on pieces of paper, right? So they had nothing. They had nothing they could argue about. They had to ignore it all. That's all they could do. And the game being to try and scare us and worry us and all this sort of stuff. Anyway, Fiona ends up for the second time in front of the Supreme Court judge in Canberra, Richard Refshajay, or however you pronounce his surname. And Fiona asked him the question, who's the highest power, man or the law? And he says that man is the highest power, but man subjugates himself under the law to have order. Now, subjugate means voluntary. So when I heard this from Fiona when she came home that night, I wasn't there. I said, wow, if I was there, I would have done something about that right there on the spot and told you how you could handle that. But anyway, it doesn't matter. The point was that he admitted that everything of the system is voluntary, right? And because it's fiction, it also means it's a curse. And this is the second part I want to point out to you, that even though we did this exercise and we willingly let ourselves be used as guinea pigs and let it play out and document it all so people can experience these kind of events and show you what you can do when you feel this, when you're not scared of death and fear of loss and all these things, you can actually create a paper trail in their world to show others how all this works and what happens here. So anyway, the second part of this, the Achilles heel of law, is to realize that every lie is a curse. And all intention to do harm are curses, because they're lies. It doesn't matter whether it's provided with full disclosure or not, it's still a curse, which means we have to clean up with those we've harmed. Now, the whole basis of the law, the way I look at it, is to protect the curse coming upon the occultists, the high-level priests who constructed the system, this matrix. And they don't want the curse to come upon them and their families and loved ones and spread out through the network. So they had to come up with a trickery to try to get around this. Now, the reasoning I'm saying this is because I feel, from the evidence I've come across, that they had tried to pull this system off once before. And it failed and was completely destroyed. And that was the civilization that went down, and the firmament and all the water came down, and all the water came up through the earth, and the floods and everything. And everything was being destroyed, and mud floods and all these things. Now, and I suspect this happened 1,200 years ago. Now, I may not be right about the timing, but the fact is it did happen. Something has happened. And the system as we know it was destroyed. And I suspect that was because of the curse. And the curse and how it comes back on you. You cannot escape what you dream for. No one can escape what they're dreaming for, regardless how much they think they're insular to it and that they don't, that they can come up with methods to avoid anything coming back on them, no matter what their ritual is or whatever. They all get it. We all, because we all have this free will, because we're all godlike. We're all gifted with this free will. So I suspected that they had experienced this disaster of their making, and they now have recreated the second coming of the system of Jesus, because Jesus, letter S and Z, Zeus means one world authority, one world power, one world system. That's what Zeus is. It's the God authority, because that's what God means, authority, the highest power in man, amongst man. It's with the highest power. And so what they did, they set up, when they came with their ships and arrived on all the lands, explained in the previous video about there's no freedom without land being free, they came with the cunning and guile to con everyone else to accept the offerings of land title deeds, of the birth certificate and the commerce and all these things. But these high-level high priests would not touch anything. So the money and the commerce and all the intellectual property and all that, they don't claim it, they don't own it. They just act as administrators over those who make the claims. So they've conned everyone into buying and accepting a title deed, a contract, a lease, a mortgage, whatever. And this is a curse straight away, because it's a lie, because it's fiction. It ain't real. There's no life there, nothing living. And they don't make the claim that they own it. Now, as it filters down from the highest points of the pyramid down, it obviously comes down to all their lackeys, and they're all making claims and owning, and so they're all being used and abused as everyone else is being used, abused, as it goes down through this whole system of others claiming ownership over intellectual property for security, for tomorrow's food on the table, for all the reasons that are the natural things that will make us a man, and to have a life and a quality of life. So that is the third part, which is not just a curse, but the fact is the trickery, the deceit. And that to me is where the Achilles heel is, because if you can step outside of the rule of law, out of all the realms of definitions that explaining everything to us, because all of it's fiction, it doesn't matter how far you dive down to the matrix, how far you go into letters and words and definitions and books and all libraries and all that, you're in fiction. But the first thing that ever happened before the ships arrived was intent. And this is where the Achilles heel is. And that's what you use to destroy them. With your intent, with our collective intent. Because we have the power to dream their own destruction. And how you do that is you say, well, you can have the dream that you're dreaming for with all this lying that you've created. And we will willingly, without intent, give it all back to you now. You can have it all. But we'll help make it happen faster. We're going to accelerate it quicker for you so you can experience those outcomes very quick. And I call this the red fever. And this red fever is where they get it. And within 24 hours, they all drop dead. They literally go. Because they're all saying they don't want to be part of life anymore. They don't want to be part of living. They are just totally devoted to fiction, where all the harm and everything else goes on, where all the destructive emotions play out. And everything is fantasy, illusion, delusion, and all those destructive emotions. Loneliness, emptiness, despair, apathy, pity, you know, insincerity, impurity, you know, suspicion, doubt, distrust, you name it. Every one of the greed, selfishness, righteousness, arrogance, indifference, ridicule, abuse. These are all of the fiction, because none of these things are real. And they play out on others. So when you wake up and you work with your good heart, work with the life. The life doesn't have any attachment to the past, the future, any emotions and all this stuff. You can actually hold it all and direct it all back to them, which we can talk about in other videos and discuss this in the new group that we just started. If enough of us are willing, and we are clearly conscious of our intent, we use their intent to kill themselves. We don't do we don't have that. We just give them permission to experience the outcomes of everything that they're dreaming for. This includes all their beneficiaries, all the lackeys, everyone involved in intelligence operations, everyone who has malevolent intent, who have been paid on the payroll, doesn't matter who they are, they all can go and be wiped out. And I think that's what happened in the first coming, when they crucified whatever really happened back then, and earthquakes appeared and devastation appeared. And I think that something like that has happened back then. As we are the highest power, and as I've experienced that in my private life in various ways, their Achilles heel is to use their lie against themselves without being caught up in it. So we don't do it as I told you so, we don't play off any games, any emotional games and rackets. We do it with absolute respect, absolute love and forgiveness, but clear intent to let them experience it in as this life, here and now, as a fever that they get and kill themselves. And then we use them as compost for our food forests. That's how I look at it now. And while we dabble in fiction, we are directing our life energy into their world and feeding their dream. When we can stop doing this and stop playing the emotions and stop being caught up in all these distractions and confusion, and we can hold the living dream through senses as we sense life, we're not imagining it anymore. We have created the space, because life is a dream, it's like a domain. And we, through our dreaming, we allow life to fill the dream with our intent. Which is how we're supposed to create children like that, when we raise them in nature. And everything should be like that. So we can also do it to them as well. So we hold the domain for all of them. And we embrace them all. And in there is this horrific red fever for them to experience, to quicken up everything so they can experience it all here and now. And so be it, because we say so, because we live it like that, and so we're living that dream and letting them have it. And don't be like Lot's wife looking back. No regret, nothing. Just let them go. Let them just vanish. Because that's what fiction is. It's anti-life. They don't want to be part of life anymore. They don't want to be here amongst the living anymore. So let them have it. Don't hold on to them. Don't hold on to their money, their land title deeds. Don't hold on to all these lies, because you feed it and give them power to keep the lie going. You let it go. Walk away with others, and we care for each other and let them have this end time. Wipe themselves out. Now, I don't know if I've explained enough, but to rehash, everything of the system to do with letters, words, numbers, definitions, no matter what, is fiction. Everything in our head that we're thinking alphabets is fiction. Anything we attach ourselves to of that fiction makes us dead. We are withdrawing from life. We're withdrawing from being life, being alive. Now, when we know who we are, if they want to kidnap your vessel and drag it into their court, they are caught. C-A-U-G-H-T. You're not caught, because you know who you are. And with intent, the curse has already started upon them. Now, they try to deflect it, but they can't do it with a man who knows what a man is, who we are, with a clear intent to let them experience the harm they are creating for themselves, for their lives, of their intent, not of this man's intent. So, it's a matter of walking away from all the offerings of the system, because it'll all be set up as traps of distraction. And there are thousands and thousands of them. There are intelligence operatives who will try to come after your character, try to bring you down through emotional manipulations. You've got to recognize the icy coldness of these intellects, these people who have malevolent intention to undermine you, so that you stick to the emotions, and they manipulate the emotions, so you cling to the matrix, you cling to the unconsciousness, the deep sleep of emotion, that's fear, doubt, uncertainty, distrust, etc., all that crap. So you've got to become removed from all of it, and you, so that you're now in your senses. They're just words, but you are the senses. So everything you're sensing, touch, taste, feel, smell, hear, see, is real. It's your living experience of life. And that experience is who you are. So you are all what you're experiencing of reality of life. Not the system constructs and concepts, all the materialism and consumerism and constructions that were derived from fiction. You know, aircraft, motor cars, all this stuff. We're all compromised by all that. But we're going to gradually let go, let go, let go of all this stuff, because it's anti-life, because we're destroying life to have these fictions. And that while we're maintaining these fictions, we're destroying more and more of life that has a purpose. Everything that has life has a purpose. So we are asleep. So when they drag your bodies into court and they call you out because of a summons, you're asleep. They're not seeing the living before them in their courts, because you're walking there as a dead man. You're a fiction. And this is where they have power, because that's the only place they have authority. In the anti-life. So when you know who you are, in this case, if they want to come and take this vessel, they have the free will to do so. They can have the force, whatever. But the curse comes upon all of them instantly, the moment they even think of it. Because I've dreamt it this way. And the more of us who do this, the more powerful it gets. Because we are the creator. We're gifted with free will to use the power of the creator to create our true lives. So we don't get into conflict. We don't get into tug of wars and reactions. We just give them the freedom to experience what they're dreaming for. That's why I'm hopeless. That's why Fiona, we've been living in our car, and our kids are doing, three of our kids are now heading into university, one in the third year, one in the second year, one in the first year. They want to do that. We can't stop them from that. That's what they want to do for now. And our youngest one is still going to high school here in Barrow. So there's a bit of house minding going on, and we're waiting to try and find another caretaking job because we don't have brothers and sisters alive who want to share life, share land, to create food for us and create a kingdom. So that's the choice. It's very hard on Fiona, being a mother and loves her children. It can be very challenging for mothers, incredibly challenging. Fiona sometimes feels she's a failure, that she's let her kids down. And I remind her, she hasn't. It's the system that's done all this. We haven't done it. We've not dreamt all this. It's not our intention to live life like this. All this has been played up by everybody else who are selfish and greedy, who live in fear, who live in uncertainty and distrust, and they hold on to all these things of the system. So they keep all the doors closed of land, where the good heart isn't flowing anymore, because nobody owns anything. I mean, you can't own your last breath, drink or meal. If you don't let go, you die. Physically, you die. And if you're holding on to all these constructs and concepts that have formed the belief systems and all the emotional attachments that have been manipulating you through so much social engineering that's been going down, so you hold on and you hold on, you hold on for tomorrow's security, tomorrow's food on the table, etc. And then also you become blind to the bigger picture of the harm we're causing, because we still want things from the system that come with an immense cost of harm to people we'll never know in their private lives. All the children who are kidnapped, brought into the education system to become blue collars, white collars and laborers in that, just so we can have that one screw that we buy at Bunnings. Tens of thousands of drones, you know, and we've had to destroy a mountain and its forest and all the creatures and cause immense disturbance there, hugest disturbance. The digging it up, the machineries we've had to manufacture, the roads we've had to build, the companies and the technologies and all that behind all that. You know, and then those roads lead to the streetlights and the crossings and the police that monitor the roads, and then the commerce, and you have to have tellers and banks because we're performing in commerce amongst it. Everyone's getting paid in every facet of all that, and it breaks into daycare and the shopping center because people have to buy food and clothing, and Farmer Joe has to make food to send it in, so all this production up for someone to, for then ends up with the raw materials that go to the companies who manufacture the screw. And then there's the marketing and the packaging, and then there's the bureaucracy and the licensing and all the government agencies and all the rules and regulations and rituals and procedures that oversee all facets of it all. And the education system that provides the convoys or the conveyor belts of children who are brought into the production line to carry on the system of this manufacturing of producing the one screw. Now, we don't know the hardships of most of these families. We don't know what they're going through because there's so much mediocrity and scarcity all caught up in the system. And that it really is, because the whole system is rooted in scarcity and mediocrity. There's only a tiny few that have all the true benefits and privileges to control the copyright of that intellectual property. Now, all this is part of the lie. It's all part of the curse. That's why I sit in the car. I don't want to support this. I'm already complicit because I'm using a mobile phone. I'm sitting in a car that's made out of that mountain that got destroyed and many other things that we're still doing. And why I'm waiting for brothers and sisters to get involved so we can create a kingdom together using whatever fictional dollars we can all pull together and learn how to stop playing out the emotional rackets, because we've already got everything. We're already on land now. The only thing that's changed is what's happened in here. This brainwashing, what's been done to us. So if we can heal all this, fix it. Well, let them go. All the people behind it, let them go. Let them have what they want. We can use them as compost later in building our food forest. Yeah, we can use bulldozers and whatever, and we'll just pile up all the bodies and bury them all and use them. They'll be productive. That's the most productive thing these people can do, because they're all dead. They're dead to life. They don't have a conscience. They don't want to work with the heart. Because harm to you is harm to me. Harm to me is harm to you. Harm to anything of life is harm to us. Harm to us is harm to all of life. We're all intrinsically connected that way. Yet there's uniqueness and originality in everything. We can go on and on about this. So the Achilles heel is their intention used against them by us giving them permission to let them experience the outcome of what they're dreaming for in this life as fast as possible, because we say so. And then we clean up the mess as we carry on with kingdom and get back to how things used to be. Everyone has free will. We have to respect that. Let them have it. Those who want to go with it, let them have it. Forget the rule of law. Forget diving into all the paperwork and systems. Rehashing again here. There's nothing there, guys. You're just in a maze of confusion. A maze of fiction, of fantasy, illusion and delusion. Imagining it's true. Imagining that the constructs that are being explained to you resonate some truth. It isn't. Because behind it is just an intention of a man. We're dealing with living man here. The fiction can't do anything. So watch out for the trickery of Freemasonry and the occults, because that's what Freemasonry is rooted in, that keep you absolved in fairy tales and myths where you're imagining what was explained to you to be true. And some has merit that you should dive in and spend years and years in its mysteries when there's nothing there. All of fiction never had anything there, and the end result of fiction is nothing, death, anti-life. That's all you can get out of it, and you'll learn nothing except not do it. Don't do it. Anyway, I'll review this, I'll end this video and have a look and see if I've achieved what I set out to do. If not, I'll have another shot another day and try it again. All the best, everyone.